Hello everyone, in this video we will be solving NTA UGC NET June 2013 question paper. If you like this video, please like, share and subscribe. It takes lot of effort to create videos like this, so this is a small contribution required from your side so that it motivates us to go do better. If you want to download the presentation or PPT that we have used in this video, then you can go to our website, which is www.digimentor.com, and you can also visit our courses section to check out our comprehensive courses for GATE, UGC NET, placement preparation and PGT examinations. You can also chat with our chat representative on the website for complete information regarding the courses. So let us start with the following video.
Hello everyone, welcome to the GATELectures.com. So in today's session I'm going to solve UGC NET paper 2, and this paper was held in June 2013. Okay, so let's start. Now the question number 1 is, COCOMO stands for, so basically the full form of the COCOMO is, it is a constructive cost model. Okay, constructive cost model. Constructive ka CO, cost ka CO, and M model ka MO. So this is a COCOMO model. So basically COCOMO model is useful to estimate, I'm writing here, is used to estimate cost of the software. Okay. So after gathering all the requirements from the users, right? So jo developer team hogi, jo software ko develop karegi, वो क्या करेगी कि with the help of COCOMO model they estimate the cost of the software. Okay, and after estimation of cost, they will give some, you know, they will give some idea to the user that the total cost of the software is that much. Okay, and one more point you can write it down is, the COCOMO model developed by Barry Boehm. Okay, and you know, this COCOMO model, it's basically consists of three models, right? In the COCOMO model we have three models. The first model name is basic model, basic COCOMO model. First one is basic COCOMO model. The second one is intermediate model, and the third one is the detailed COCOMO model, right? So what is the difference between these three in different models? Like first is basic, then second is intermediate, and the third one is the detailed model. So the difference between these three model is, first one is basic model. So basic model ko hum kahan use karte hain, jab hume, you know, when we want to estimate the cost of the software in a very quick and in a very rough manner, कि आपको उसी टाइम आपको एस्टिमेट करना है सॉफ्टवेयर की कॉस्ट का, कि ये आफ्टर कंप्लीशन ऑफ द सॉफ्टवेयर ये कितना कॉस्ट लेगी. उसमें हम कौन सा यूज़ करते हैं, बेसिक मॉडल यूज़ करते हैं. ऑल्दो दे आर नॉट करेक्ट, बट येस इट्स वेरी क्विक मैनर कि आप एस्टिमेट कर सकें कॉस्ट ऑफ द सॉफ्टवेयर. फिर आता है इंटरमीडिएट मॉडल. इंटरमीडिएट मॉडल में क्या रहता है कि ये इतना क्विक नहीं होता जितना बेसिक मॉडल है, बट यस इट विल गिव सम एक्यूरेट और सम यू नो यू कैन से अप्रोक्सीमेटली एक्यूरेट कॉस्ट ऑफ द सॉफ्टवेयर. लाइकवाइज इन द डिटेल मैनर इज ऑल्सो स्लो एज कंपेरेटिवली इंटरमीडिएट मॉडल, बट इट विल गिव यू द यू कैन से इट विल गिव यू द एक्यूरेट estimation of the cost of the software, right? So this is all about introduction part for COCOMO model, right? Now the question number 2 is, match the following. So first one is good quality. This question is come from software engineering only, so they are talking about the software qualities, software correctness, कितना सॉफ्टवेयर की प्रेडिक्टिबिलिटी हो सकती है, रिलायबिलिटी कितनी हो सकती है सॉफ्टवेयर की. सो यू हैव टू मैच विद दिस देयर फंक्शनैलिटी. सो फर्स्ट वन इज गुड क्वालिटी. इफ they are talk about the good quality software, then you can say that it should, you can say it should meet all the functional requirements and all the non-functional requirements. A functional requirements and non-functional requirement kya hote hai? Sabse pehle hum wo padhte hain in a very quick manner. So first one is functional requirement. So we have requirements, right? User requirements. So first one is functional requirements, and the second one is non-functional requirements. So inke beech mein kya difference hai? In the functional requirements, right, we specify, or you can say we describes what the system has to do, ki hamara system kya kya kar sakta hai, without specifying that how it going to be do, but we are describing here only the what the system has to do, or we specify in the functional requirements like what are the expectations from the software, whether the expectations from users or developers, what are the expectations. Basically, expectations are coming from the users, right? So this is a, what are the expectations from user, from the software, and we also, you know, specify here what the software should not to do, right? What the software should not to do. So in the functional requirement, we specify some features like ki hamara system kya kya kar sakta hai, what the system has to do, hamara system kya kya nahi kar sakta, ye bhi hum specify karte hai, what the system should not to do, and what are the expectations from the software, hamari expectations kya hai software se. So these things we specify in the functional requirements. Next हमारा आता है functional, non-functional requirements. अब non-functional requirements में we specify, I'm writing here, we specify how well the software performs, how well the software performs its functions. कितनी अच्छी तरह से आपका software functions को perform कर रहा है, right? So ये functionality को check करने के लिए there is two sides. एक तो for user side कि user की जो expectations है उस वो सारी features की अच्छे से perform कर रहा है या नहीं, and for the developer side. Okay? So first one is for user side. For user side कि वो कितना सॉफ्टवेयर परफॉर्म कर रहा है, तो हम उसमें क्या देखेंगे कि क्या हमारे सॉफ्टवेयर की हाई परफॉर्मेंस है या नहीं, हाई परफॉर्मेंस, और हम चेक कर सकते हैं कि हमारा सॉफ्टवेयर रिलायबल है या नहीं, रिलायबिलिटी चेक करते हैं. अगर हम डेवलपर्स की साइड की बात करें तो डेवलपर देखेगा कि क्या ये इसकी मेंटेनेंस ऑफ द सॉफ्टवेयर इज इजी और नॉट, टेस्टेबिलिटी कैसी है, टेस्टेबिलिटी we check from the developer's side. So these are the requirements, functional and non-functional requirements. Now come back to the question. So good quality software ke liye hume meet honi chahiye functional requirements bhi, ki hamara system kya kya kar sakta hai, kya nahi kar sakta hai, kya hamari expectations hai, aur non-functional requirements bhi hamari meet karni chahiye ki hamara software kitne acche se perform kar raha hai, whether from the user side ki hum usme check karte hain ki wo kitna high performance de raha hai, kya reliabilities hai, aur developer ki side se bhi hum check karte hain ki maintainable hai ya testability iski easy hai ya nahi. To good quality software ki agar hum baat kare to it should meet both functional and the non-functional requirements. Okay, next is correctness. So correctness mein hum kya define, you can say kya describe karte hain ki we describe how user can interact with the software, right? And how software should behave when it is used correctly. Okay, so for correctness में हम just meet करवाते हैं functional requirements को, right? कि इसमें क्या हो रहता है कि user and software की interaction रहती है and so we meet the functional requirement in the correctness. And predictable के लिए predictable basically it's a process which is under the statistical control. So it is whether the this is the process is under the statistical control. And the reliability क्या होती है कि reliability basically characteristics होती है which states that program does not fail for a specified time in a given particular environment, right? कि अगर कोई आपका you can say कुछ मॉड्यूल सॉफ्टवेयर के अगर खराब हो गए या फिर आपके काम नहीं करे तो it should not like कि पूरा का पूरा ही सॉफ्टवेयर आपका करप्ट हो गया. So program does not fail for a specified time in a given environment. कोई भी environment है, कोई भी particular time पे वो आपका program should not be fail. So तभी हम कहेंगे कि reliability of software की कितनी है according to this function, right? So D is first. Predictable, for predictability we check it's just in a statistical control. Correctness के लिए we meet the functional requirements and good quality product के लिए we should meet the functional requirements and the non-functional requirements. So option E is the right one. Okay. Now question number third is while estimating the cost of the software, line of code and function points are used to measure which one of the following. The first one is length of code. B is size of software. C is functionality of software. And the D is the none of the above. Now, for size estimation of software, कि हमारा software का कितना size होगा, we have two things. First one is line of code. The short form is LOC, line of code. And the second one is FP, or you can say function count. Function point, or you can function count, right? So we have two things. So let's talk about LOC first. So basically LOC is a line of code, right? So in a source code, the number of lines present included all kinds of declarations or actual code, including logic and all kinds of computations. So we include everything and we count the number of lines. And in between, if blank spaces are come or comments are come, so we are not included in the lines. So basically, we count the declarations, actual code, logic, and computations. We are not included blank space and comments in the lines. And then we count the number of lines and we give some estimation that this is the size of your software. इसकी एक एडवांटेज भी है, डिसएडवांटेज भी है. एडवांटेज क्या है कि इट्स अ वेरी इजी टू काउंट एंड कैलकुलेट फ्रॉम द डेवलप्ड कोड. और डेवलप्ड कोड आपने जस्ट यू कैन से ब्लैंक स्पेसेस को एंड कमेंट्स को आपने डिलीट किया, कंसीडर नहीं किया, एंड देन यू जस्ट काउंट द नंबर ऑफ लाइंस व्हिच इज रिटन इन द कोड एंड यू गिव सम एस्टिमेशन ऑफ द साइज ऑफ द सॉफ्टवेयर. बट there is a one disadvantage is also because different programming languages mein agar aap kaam karein, different programming languages have different codes, right? So for different codes we have different line of codes, right? So agar line of code different languages mein vary karega, to it's very easy to predict the size of the software for different languages. So that's why we jump to the function point. So function point mein kya hota hai ki basically it measures, I'm writing here, it measures the functionality from user point of view, So basically function point is not dependent on the language, or you can say on any technology. So function point basically works like whatever the user request from the software, right? Whatever, this is a system. So whatever the user request you can say request from the software, and whatever it receives, whatever it receive in return, that thing considered as a function point. Okay, so basically this function point focus on what the functionality is being delivered to the user. So hum isme kya kar rahe hain ki functionality ke upar we are dependent, we are not dependent on the line of code. So that's why and that is how we are calculating the size of the software. So line of code and function point basically is a size, is used for the size estimation of the size of software. So B is the right one. Now question number 4 is, a good software design must have high module coupling, high module cohesion, high module coupling, low module cohesion, low module coupling, high module cohesion, or low module coupling and low module cohesion. So let's talk about first cohesion and coupling, and then I will tell you for a good software design we required high or low coupling, or high or you can say high or low cohesion. So let's talk about first cohesion and coupling. So basically when we develop some software, so we develop some modules, right? Then we interact these modules together. So let's suppose in this one module, this is a module number 1, this is a module number 2, this is a module number 3. We have 3 modules, let's suppose. And in these modules, we have some elements also there. Elements also present. Okay. So coupling. Coupling means pair. Pair coupling. So if 2 modules are here, so inke beech mein jo interaction hoga, or you can say the relationship between these 2 modules, usse hum kya kahenge? Coupling. So I'm writing here the definition of coupling. So basically coupling is a measure of degree of interdependence between the modules. Interdependence or relationship, interdependence between the modules. Between the modules. मॉड्यूल्स के बीच में कितना इंटरडिपेंडेंसी है, कितना रिलेशनशिप है, कितने हाउ स्ट्रॉन्गली दे आर कनेक्टेड विद ईच अदर. सो ये सब की मेजरमेंट कौन करता है? कपलिंग. ओके. और अगर हम कोहेजन की बात करें तो मैंने आपको बताया है कि अगर डिफरेंट डिफरेंट मॉड्यूल्स वी हैव इन बिटवीन इन द मॉड्यूल्स वी हैव सम एलिमेंट्स, राइट? सो एलिमेंट्स का क्या रहता है कि हाउ स्ट्रॉन्गली दे आर कनेक्टेड, हाउ यू नो हाउ these elements in a module are connected. So I'm writing here the definition of cohesion. So it is a degree to which elements of a module are related to each other, whether they are strongly related to each other or whether they are loosely related to each other. Okay, so this is the main difference. In the coupling we are talking about the different modules, how they are connected with each other, how they are interdependent with each other. And in the cohesion we are talking about the how, you know, in a module how elements are related to each other. So this is the main difference. Now the question is ki for a good software design ke liye hame high cohesion chahiye ya low cohesion chahiye, high coupling चाहिए, low coupling चाहिए? This is a question, right? So let's talk about the high coupling first. High coupling means high interdependency between the modules. Means that this is a module number 1 and this is a module number 2. So अगर ये दो modules हैं and ये strongly connected है एक दूसरे के साथ, so it means that अगर ये strongly connected है, then क्या होगा कि मान लो अगर हमें कोई change इस software के अंदर लेके आना है, there is some error, this is some part of the software and यहाँ पर कुछ एरर आ रहा है या फिर मुझे कुछ मॉडिफिकेशन करनी है. सो इसका क्या होगा कि अगर दे आर हाईली कनेक्टेड विद ईच अदर और यू कैन से स्ट्रॉन्गली कनेक्टेड विद ईच अदर, तो जो मैं यहाँ चेंजेस करूँगी इस मॉड्यूल के अंदर या फिर यहाँ पर कुछ एरर आ गया इस मॉड्यूल के अंदर, तो उसका इफेक्ट इस मॉड्यूल के ऊपर भी आएगा बिकॉज दे आर स्ट्रॉन्गली कनेक्टेड विद ईच अदर. बिकॉज बट वी डोंट वॉन्ट दिस टाइप ऑफ सिचुएशन. वी वॉन्ट कि अगर हम किसी मॉड्यूल में चेंज कर रहे हैं या फिर उस मॉड्यूल में कोई एरर आ रहा है, तो वी डोंट वॉन्ट कि अदर मॉड्यूल्स आर ऑल्सो अफेक्टेड बिकॉज ऑफ दिस मॉड्यूल, राइट? सो दैट्स वाई वी डोंट वॉन्ट हाई कपलिंग, वी वॉन्ट लो कपलिंग फॉर अ गुड सॉफ्टवेयर डिजाइन. ओके, सो दिस पॉइंट इज क्लियर ना. एंड द सेकेंड वन इज वी वॉन्ट हाई कोहेजन और लो कोहेजन. ओके, सो लेट सपोज दीज आर द एलिमेंट्स विच इज प्रेजेंट इन द मॉड्यूल, राइट? सो अगर ये एलिमेंट एक फंक्शनैलिटी को फॉलो कर रहा है, ये मॉड्यूल ये एलिमेंट एक फंक्शनैलिटी को फॉलो कर रहा है, तो दैट वी वॉन्ट कि जो बाकी मॉड्यूल्स है वो भी हाईली उस फंक्शनैलिटी को फॉलो करें, राइट? तभी वो एक मॉड्यूल एक पर्टिकुलर काम को कर पाएगा. लेट सपोज कि ये एक एडिशन का मॉड्यूल है एंड ये एलिमेंट एडिशन परफॉर्म करता है, तो वी वॉन्ट कि जो बाकी जो मॉड्यूल्स प्रेजेंट है वो भी वो सेम फंक्शनैलिटी को फोकस करें, सेम फीचर को रिप्रेजेंट करें. सो दैट्स वाई वी वॉन्ट कि इनके बीच में रिलेशन बहुत अच्छा हो, दे आर रिलेटेड विथ ईच अदर स्ट्रॉन्गली. सो वी फॉर अ हाई यू कैन से फॉर अ गुड सॉफ्टवेयर डिजाइन वी वॉन्ट हाई कोहेजन सो दैट दे विल शो द सेम फीचर in a module. So we want high cohesion and for a good software design we want low coupling. So correct answer is high module, no, it's a low module coupling and we want high module cohesion. So option C is the right one. Okay, question number 5 is cyclometric complexity of a flow graph G with n vertices and E edges A. So first I'm drawing the any flow graph. Let's suppose A is equal to 10. This is the relation. This is a condition is there. Now B is greater than C. One more condition. Then if B is greater than C, then A is equal to C. And A is equal to B. Right? And then and F. Okay, then and this is print A, B and C. Okay, and this is how, this is my flow graph. Okay, and this is the flow graph. In the flow graph, vertices are, now count the number of vertices and edges. So vertices are 1 2 3 4 5 6 7, right? We have number of vertices are 7 in this flow graph and edges are 1 2 3 4 5 6 7 and 8. So we have 8 number of edges. Number of edges are 8. Now to find the cyclometric complexity of a flow graph, there is one formula. Formula is, this is equal to E minus N plus 2P. So where is P is a predicate logic, and if P value is not given, then it's okay. We are considering P is equal to 1. So this is a formula, and here I'm putting the value of E is number of edges are 8, number of what? Ticks are 7, then plus 2. So this is 8 minus 7 is 1, 1 plus 2 is 3. So this is 3. So basically this is a, in this, if we talk about the cyclometric complexity, So cyclometric complexity, basically it is a software metric which is used to measure the complexity of a program. कि आपका program कितना complex है. So अगर 3 value है, so there are some values are there in the cyclometric complexity में कि अगर value 1 आती है, 2 आती है, 3 आती है, 4 आती है, 5 आती है, तो यहाँ पर आपकी complexity थोड़ी कम है, यहाँ से फिर आपकी थोड़ी सी complexity of a program increase होती रहेगी gradually. Okay, so now with the help of this formula E minus N plus 2P, you are able to find the complexity of your program. So E minus N plus 2P, this B is the right one, here P value they are considering 1. Now question number 6 is, when the following code is executed, what will be the value of X and Y? So they initialize some variable. So there is one variable, this is the integer, where data type is integer. X, they stored one in the X variable, and the Y value is 0. So this is the post increment operation. So in the post increment operation, mein kya hota? First they assign the value to this variable Y. This is the assignment operator na. So the value of X is 1. So they assigned the value of 1 in the Y. So Y ki value ab kya ho jayegi? 1. And then they increment the value of X. So X ki value first pehle kya thi? 1. Ab kya ho gayi? 2. Because this is a post increment. Post increment ka kya matlab hota hai? First you are going to assign the value of X to the Y, and then you increment the value of X. So finally we got the value of X is 2 and the value of Y is 1. So 2 and 1. So option A is the right one. Now the question number 7 is, how many values can be held by an array A? So this is the values, right? I'm writing here. So it's like this is the array, and the values are like minus 1 to m, and this is 1 to m. Okay, so basically this is a 2D, two dimensional array, where total number of rows is equal to, this is the last number m, this is the first number, this is minus 1, and this is plus 1. Basically, when we find the total number of rows, let's suppose numbers are like 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, like this. And the numbering is 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Okay, and some numbers is present, A, B, C, D, E. Okay, you find out the total number of size of this arrays. So the last one is 5, and we minus the first value is 1, and this is 4. 5 minus 1 is 4, and we add one value, so this is 4 plus 1 is 5. So the size of the array is 5. 1 2 3 4 5. This is how we calculate the size of the array. So last element, last value minus first value plus 1. So this is how we calculate the total number of rows. Last value is m, first value is minus 1, we minus with last with the first, and then we add 1. So finally we got m plus 1 plus 1 is equal to m plus 2. Same in the case of when we find the total number of columns. So columns may be same. So this, they are the columns. So the last value is m, first value is 1. So we minus 1, and we increment, we add 1 here. So this 1 and minus 1 is cancelled, and we got 1. So what is the total size of the array? So size of the array is row into number of rows equal into number of columns. So number of rows kitni hai hamare paas? M plus 2. And number of columns kitna hai hamare paas? M. So this is the answer. So M into M plus 2 is the right answer. So question number 8 is, what is the result of the expression? So this is the expression. The first operation is 1 and 2. Okay, so 1 and 2 is basically, it is a bitwise AND operation. So this is 1 and 2. So this is a bitwise operation. Okay, so how we represent 1? So this is 0, 1. And how we represent 2? This is 1, 0. And bitwise AND operation we applied. 1 and 0, you know, 0 and 0 and 1 is also 0. Okay, so we got 0, 0. And 3 and 4. So 3 and 4 will give you a 0 as an integer result, right? So therefore, this 0, the value of this is also 0. So 0 plus 0 is equal to 0. So answer is 0. Now question number 9 is, how many times the word print shall be printed by the following program segment? So first there is a for loop for I, then j, for k, and then we finally print. So it's like this. For I is equal to 1, I is less than equal to 2, then I is plus plus, then we go in the inner loop. This is 4, then j is equal to 1, j is less than or equal to 2, and then j plus plus, okay. And then we go to the next inner loop. This is k is equal to 1, this is k is less than 2, and then k plus plus, and we go into inner statement. So this is print, f print, okay. So you have to identify how many times this printf statement will execute. Okay. So now, when for I is equal to 1 and j is equal to 1. Okay. When I is equal to 1, I is less than 2, right? So it goes to here in the inner loop. So j is equal to 1. Now the value of j is equal to 1 and j is less than 2, right? So now it goes to the here. So for k is equal to 1, yes, and k value is less than 2. So we print this statement, okay. So first time we print here, and then again we go here and we increment the value of k. Now the k value is 2, right? Up k ki value, now in this case k value is 2. Now k is less than or equal to 2. Yes, k is equal to 2. Then again we print the statement, okay. So how many times we printed? 2 times here. 2 times. Now again, when I value is 1, then this is completed. Now the loop is going here, and this is completed, then j value is going to be increment. Now the j value is from 1 to 2. J is equal to 2. Then again we come back to the inner loop. So in this case I is equal to 1 and j value is equal to 2. Then again this, for k is equal to 1 ke liye, we print the statement one time, and again this k value is going to be increment. Now again this print is going to be executed. So how many times? 2 times. Now again, so this is completed. Now this loop is going to be here. Now for I is equal to 2, this I is going to be incremented, and j value, now it goes to the this inner loop. So j is equal to 1. For this, for j is equal to 1, it goes here, right? So it goes here. So for k is equal to 1 ke liye, it go, this print statement is executed, and for k is equal to 2 ke liye, then again this statement is printed. So this is 2 times is going to be print, then I is equal to 2 and j value is 2. Then again we go to the inner loop, and this for k is equal to 1 ke liye this print statement, and for k is equal to 2 ke liye this print statement, again 2 times. Now calculate how many times we execute the we print this statement, print this statement, print. So this is 2 times, 2 times, 2 times, 2 times, 4 times 2. So this is 2 into 2 into 2 into 2 is 8. Option D is the right one. Now question number 10 is, which of the following is not a type of database management system? First one is hierarchical, B is network, C is relational, and D is sequential. So we have different models of DBMS. So I am just writing here, DBMS models, different DBMS models. So first one is hierarchical model, hierarchical model. So initially this model comes. Now after this, the next model is network model. Network model. So after the network model, relational model comes. Relational model. And you know that this model is widely used. Nowadays we are using this model. We are not using network and hierarchical model. Let's discuss some introduction about hierarchical model and the network model. So hierarchical model, basically in this type of model, the data is stored, or you can say organized into tree-like structure. As a name suggests, hierarchical. So in a tree-like structure like this. There is one parent node and the childs. One parent node, childs. One parent node, childs, and so on, like this. So you can see that in the hierarchical model, so if there is a tree-like structure, so there is one parent and their many children are there. So what is the relation between them? The relation is one to many. So they hold one to many relationship. Okay. Right? Because there is one parent and there are so many children are there. In this, there's two children. It may be a possibility that there's three children. Like now the network model. So after the hierarchical model, network model comes. So basically, network model is the extension of hierarchical model. Hierarchical model. So in this network model, the data is organized like. In the hierarchical model, the data is organized like tree-like structure, but in the network model, the data is organized like a graph-like structure. Like a graph is going to be four nodes are here and they are connected like this. So this type of structure is in the network model, and you can see that there is no parent and no child like procedure. So you can say that the relation is many to many relationship, more than one parent bhi ho sakte hai, right? Now the next one is relational model. Relational model, you know that it is a widely used model, and iske andar jo data stored hota hai, data stored in this relational model, the data stored in the relational model in tables only. Aur un tables ko hum kya kehte hain, we call these tables a relations. Let's suppose this is a table and this is student table, in which some attributes are there, like student ID, student name, right, class. So these are the columns, right? Columns ko hum kehte hain attributes. They have unique, you can say they have same domain values are present here. Let's suppose student ID, integer types, store like 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. So same domain values are present. Names mein A, B, C, D, E. Class, first class, second class, third class, fourth class, fifth class, like this. So these rows are tuples in the relation, and these columns are the attributes in this relation. Okay, so this is a relational model. Network model is like a graph like model, many to many relationship, and in the hierarchical model, it's a tree like structure and one to many relationship they hold. So now come back to the question, which of the following is not a type of database management system? Hierarchical model is all there, network model is there, relational model is there. The left one is sequential model, it is not there. Question 11 is manager salary details are to be hidden from employees table. This technique is called as conceptual level data hiding, physical level data hiding, external level data hiding and logical level data hiding. So basically we have different levels are there. So if we talk about the lowest level is physical level. So physical level, basically it's the lowest level and it describes the physical storage structure of data in the database, or whether they are, how they are stored in the database. So they specifies, or you can say they, in the physical level we describes physical storage, how actually your data are stored in the database. Physical storage structure of data, physical storage structure of data in DBMS. After this, the next layer is conceptual level. So next layer is conceptual level. So in the conceptual level, basically you can say it hides all the internal details of the physical structure, internal details like how actually the data are stored in the database, and it will give you the structure of whole database for a group of users. Let's suppose in the database some different kinds of data is stored, like student information is also stored, teacher information is also stored, but for a group of users ke liye, like agar hame students ki details chahiye, for a particular students ki agar mujhe details chahiye, so for that main sirf utna hi, you know, data main specify karungi, utna hi structure main show karungi. So in the conceptual level mein aap kya karte ho, in the conceptual level mein you hides all the internal details of the physical structure, hides all the internal details of physical structure. You are only showing, or you can say you are just structured the database for a group of users. Group of users ke liye utna hi aap data ko aap show kar rahe ho. Uske baad, after the conceptual level, next level is external level. External level. ये वो लेवल होता है जिसपे व्यूज यूजर्स आर एबल टू सी. ओके, पर्टिकुलर यूजर, पर्टिकुलर इंडिविजुअल यूजर के लिए यू आर शोइंग द पर्टिकुलर डेटा. ओके, सो इट इज अ, यू कैन से इट इज द अपर लेयर, इट इज वेरी क्लोज टू द यूजर एंड इट व्यू डेटा फॉर अ स्पेसिफाइड, फॉर अ इंडिविजुअल एंड यूजर्स के लिए you are specifying it. Let's suppose अगर आपके पास एक कंपनी है, इस कंपनी में क्या है कि different departments हैं, like ये testing department है, developer department है, HR department है, accounts department है. Let's suppose, so ये सारी informations क्या है कि DBMS के अंदर stored है, इस कंपनी के DBMS के अंदर स्टोर है. लेट्स सपोज दिस इज अ टीसीएस कंपनी एंड ये सारी इंफॉर्मेशन इसके अंदर स्टोर है. सो दिस इज अ फिजिकल लेवल. फिजिकल लेवल में यू आर एबल टू सी ऑल द डिटेल्स. कंसेप्चुअल लेवल में क्या है कि फॉर अ ग्रुप ऑफ यूजर्स के यू आर एबल टू सी द डिटेल्स. लाइक अगर मुझे पर्टिकुलर एचआर डिपार्टमेंट की अगर डिटेल्स को शो करना है तो मैं कंसेप्चुअल लेवल पे आके उसे चेक करूंगी. बट एचआर डिपार्टमेंट में कोई, लेट्स सपोज कोई राम है, कोई श्याम है, आई सपोज टू पर्सन आर देयर, राम एंड श्याम, एंड मुझे पर्टिकुलर राम की सैलरी को अगर मुझे चेक करना है या उसकी डिटेल्स को मुझे लेना है तो मैं एक्सटर्नल लेवल पे ही उसे चेक करूँगी फॉर अ स्पेसिफाइड पर्सन. बट फॉर अ होल एच आर टीम के लिए मुझे अगर डिटेल्स को चेक करना है तो आई एम गोइंग टू द कंसेप्चुअल लेवल लाइक दिस. Now come back to the question. Manager's salary details are to be hidden from the employees table. सारे जो एम्प्लॉय टेबल्स है, मैनेजर की जो सैलरीज है वो इज गोइंग टू बी हिडन फ्रॉम द एम्प्लॉयज टेबल. दिस टेक्निक को हम कहते हैं कंसेप्चुअल लेवल data hiding for the group of users ke liye hum hide kar rahe hain, managers. So all managers are included here. So this is going to be in a conceptual level data hiding. Okay. Now question number 13 is, which normal form is considered as adequate for usual database design? We have different normal forms like 1NF, 2NF, 3NF, 5NF, BCNF, like this, right? So let's talk about 1NF one by one. And here's the diagram. This is 2NF here, then 3NF. Then I'm going to explain it one by one. This is BCNF. Then 4NF and after that 5NF. Okay, so you know that every normal form is in the 2NF, is in 1NF, so I'm not considering the 1NF. Then let's talk about the 2NF. So 2NF basically, you know that it should be in the first normal form, the one point is there. And the second one is, you know, guys, it should not have a partial dependency. So any kind of partial dependencies we are going to remove in the, it's not allowed in the 2NF, right? So then we move to the 3NF. So if partial dependency is there, then we move to the 3NF. So here we are going to remove the all kinds of partial dependencies. So basically, this 3NF, it is in the 2NF and it does not have any transitive dependency. So it take care of that, it should not have any transitive dependencies present in the table. Then we move further. So this is the BCNF. So BCNF kya hai ki BCNF basically high version hai third normal form ka, right? So this form basically deals you can say all type of anomaly which is not handled by the 3NF. Like if transitive property is there, so it's not handled by 3NF, then it goes to the BCNF and it take care of all kinds of anomalies. So although the BCNF is the high version of 3NF, but BCNF are not able to, you know, give guarantee of functional dependencies, whether they preserve it or not, functional dependencies. So BCNF basically does not give guarantee of functional dependencies. But if we talk about the 3NF, so it gives us the guarantee of functional dependencies plus lossless join. Okay. So we can see that yes, among them, up to 3NF, it's quite adequate for a usual database design. So 3NF is more than enough. So option B is the right one. Now question number 14, if D1, D2 and DN are the domains in a relational model, called relational model, and D1, D2 and up to DN are the domains in a relational model, then the relation is in a table which is a subset of. So basically the value of relation is a subset of, the value of the relation is a subset of Cartesian products of all the domains. Cartesian products of all the domains. Okay. So option B is the right one. Now question number 15.
Hello everyone. In this video, we will be solving NTA UGC NET June 2013 question paper. If you want to download the presentation or PPT that we have used in this video, then you can go to our website, which is www.digimentor.com. Over there, from the download section, you can download the presentation. And you can also visit our courses section to check out our comprehensive courses for GATE, UGC NET, Placement Preparation and PGT examinations. You can also chat with our chat representative on the website for complete information regarding the courses. So let us start with the following video.
Question number 15 is, which of the following addresses is used to deliver a message to the correct application program running on a host? So first one is port address, B is IP address, C is logical address and D is physical address. So let's talk about the whole scenario. You know that if this is a network, let's suppose this is a network 1 and this is a network number 2. Okay, so many hosts are there in this network and in this network, like so many computers are present like this, right? Now, so these two systems or these two hosts wants to communicate or wants to you can say transfer some data. So from this to this, okay, let's suppose this is server and this one is client, and both are present on different networks, right? So, and you know that in between there are number of routers are there, okay? So when the delivery is between the from one router to another router, this will be done by the data link layer. So basically data link layer is responsible for delivery of frames between the nodes. So this system, this client sends some frames. So delivery between the nodes is, it's the responsibility of the data link layer. Now the next is, what is the responsibility of network layer? Network layer responsibility is, this system is present in this network and this system is present in another network. So to transfer the frame from this network to this network, network to network, or to that particular, because in this network there are so many hosts are there, so to send the frame to that particular host is the responsibility of network layer. So network layer is the delivery of datagrams between the two hosts. Now the next one is transport layer. So transport layer is responsibility that in this system there are so many process are going on, right? So many process. So for the particular process, right, process to process delivery is done by the data link layer, or sorry, transport layer. So the thing is, अगर ये host है and यहाँ पर आपका receiver है, तो अगर आपको उसे कुछ फ्रेम सेंड करना है तो सबसे पहले राउटर टू राउटर डिलीवरी होगी, तो वो किसकी हेल्प से होगी? डेटा लिंक लेयर से. फिर वो जो फ्रेम्स है वो किस, हम पर बहुत सारे नेटवर्क्स अवेलेबल, तो किस पर्टिकुलर नेटवर्क के किस सिस्टम के पास जाना है, दैट इज द रिस्पॉन्सिबिलिटी ऑफ नेटवर्क लेयर. एंड उस सिस्टम के अंदर सो मैनी प्रोसेसेस आ रहे, किस प्रोसेस को देना है वो रिस्पॉन्सिबिलिटी किसकी है? ट्रांसपोर्ट लेयर की, राइट? Now we have three layers: data link layer, second one is network layer, and the third one is transport layer. Okay, so data link layer is responsible to send the frame between the nodes. Up there are so many number of nodes, kis particular node ko hume send karna hai, we use, for that we need MAC address. Right? MAC address ko physical address bhi kehte hain. So this is the data link layer use the MAC address. Now the network layer. Ab in a particular network, hume kis particular system par hume frame ko send karna hai, uske liye we need IP address. And उस particular system में किस particular process को we have to send the frames, for that we need port address, or not port address, it's, we call it a port number. So port number is, we need port number to choose among the multiple processes which is running on the, destination host, we choose one particular process, right? Now we know that port number port number is of 16 bit. Port number is a 16 bit integer, and the range of the port number is from 0 to 65,535. This is the range of the port numbers. It is a 16 bit integer, and this is the range. Now let's come back to our question. The question says that which of the following addresses is used to deliver a message to a correct application program running on a host. Matlab, if at particular host, if any application program is running on, or to deliver a message to that particular program, for that we need which address? MAC address, jiske hum physical address bhi kehte hain. IP address ko hum logical address bhi kehte hain. It's same. Okay, and this is a transport layer, this is a port number. So for that we need port number, not IP address. Not IP address and logical address is same, physical address and MAC address is same. Okay, now let's next question is question number 16. In which substitution method a character in the plain text is always changed to the same character in the cipher text regardless of its position in the next? So option number A is polyalphabetic, B is mono alphabetic, C is transpositional, and D is multi-alphabetic. When we convert plain text to ciphertext, okay, so for that we need different methods. Like we have two methods. First method is transposition cipher. Transposition cipher. And the next method is substitution cipher. Substitution cipher. Okay. So these two methods are there to convert the plain text to the cipher text. Right. Then what is the difference between these two methods? Let's suppose the plain text is hello, and we have to convert it into the ciphertext so that attacker are not able to identify. Okay, so hello is there. So in the transposition ciphertext, we are only rearranged the original characters. इन द रीजनिंग में आपने ये क्वेश्चन किए होंगे कि आपको कोई वर्ड दिया होता है, उसके वर्ड जम्बल्ड होते हैं, राइट, एंड यू हैव टू आइडेंटिफाई कि ये वर्ड किस वर्ड से बिलोंग करता है, राइट. अगर मैं ये हेलो है और अगर मैं इसके वर्ड्स को सिर्फ जम्बल्ड कर रही हूँ, राइट, लाइक दिस, एंड यू हैव टू आइडेंटिफाई कि ओरिजिनल मैसेज क्या था. ठीक है, तो एक तो ये मेथड है कि साइफर टेक्स्ट कि हमारे अटैकर्स को पता ना लगे, तो हम क्या करते हैं, हमें प्लेन टेक्स्ट के ही जो ओरिजिनल हमारे कैरेक्टर्स हैं उन्हीं को जम्बल करके और हम सेंड कर देते हैं. तो दिस इज द वन मेथड, बट दिस मेथड इज नॉट यू कैन से सेफ. पीपल आर इजली एबल टू आइडेंटिफाई. नाउ देयर इज सम अदर मेथड इज देयर, सब्स्टिट्यूशन साइफर. सब्स्टिट्यूशन साइफर में क्या होता है कि इफ देयर इज हेलो, राइट, so I'm replacing these words with some another characters, these words with some these characters with some other characters, and right, like I'm representing H with X, representing E with any letter like T, now L I'm representing with G, and O I'm representing with A, right. So this is a cipher, substitution cipher text. In this I'm converting the plain text into the cipher text with the help of substitution method. In the substitution method, I'm not using the same original characters, I'm using some other different characters, and I'm converting this plain text to cipher text. Now substitution cipher is also two types. First type is mono alphabetic, and the second type is polyalphabetic. Now the difference between monoalphabetic and the polyalphabetic is what? I'm telling you. Now you can see that when I convert this plain text to the cipher text, these two characters, LL is repeated, right? So I repeat GG in the cipher text also. Now if some attacker is present here, right? So he's easily able to identify that GG is repeated. It means that in the plain text, some character is there which is repeated two times, right? So he gets some idea. So that's why we further divided this into two parts. Polyalphabetic is more secure because although the letters are repeated in the original text, here I am giving some other values or some other characters to that repeated word also. So this method is more secure, and this monoalphabetic may the same case. If the letters are repeated, then I'm replacing with the same letters, right? So each character replaced by any rest of the 25 characters which is present here, right? So there is the relation between in them is 1-to-1, and there is relationship between them is 1-to-many, because 1-to-many because यहाँ पर अगर LL repeated है तो हमने इसमें original cipher text जब हमने convert किया तो हमने इसमें repeat नहीं किया, we replaced it with the rest of the characters, right? It is more secure, it is less secure, because in this attacker gets some idea that some letter should be repeated, but here the attacker is not get any idea. Now come back to our question. So in the question they said that which substitution method a character in the plain text is always changed to the same character in the cipher text regardless to its position in the text. They say that regardless to the position, agar plain text mein agar some values are repeated, same value, so ciphertext mein we are also using the same value for both the repeated characters, right? Same character in the ciphertext regardless to its position. So kaun si type hai? Transpositional is not a type of substitution method, right? You know that when we convert plain text to ciphertext, there is two methods, transposition and substitution. And substitution ki further division hai monoalphabetic and polyalphabetic. So these two are wrong. Monoalphabetic is the right choice, and polyalphabetic is the correct is not the right choice. So this is B, because we are changed the same character, the same characters, not with the different characters, right? So option B is the right one. Now question number 17, in classful addressing the IP address, this is the IP address, and you have to identify which class this IP address belongs to. So I'm drawing a table of IP addresses. Now this is class A, class B, class C, class D and class E. We have in the classful addressing we have five classes, class A, B, C, D, E, and according to that we are divided the IP addresses. Now the range for class A is 1 to 126. The original range is 0 to 127, but in between 0 to 127, 0 and 127, these two IP addresses we are not going to use, because this address is used for the network ID. This particular address is used for the network ID. Let's suppose this is the network, right? And in this class A IP addresses are present, so that particular first address is going to represent this whole network ID, and this 127 represent the broadcasting, used for the broadcasting. So that's why the portion range is 1 to 126. Now the next one is class B. So class B ranges 128 to 191. Okay, Next is class C, the range is 192 to 223. For class D, 224 to 239. And for class E is 240 to 255. So this is the range for class A, B, C, D and E. Okay. Class D and class E is not in, you know, that much use. It's used for the multicasting and for the future use. So we are not considering mostly class D and E. Class A, B and C mostly are in used. So if we, you know, if we divide, if this is a class, if this is IP address, 32-bit IP address, this IP address we divide into two parts. First part is for network ID and the second part is for the host ID. So we give 8 bits to the network ID and for host ID we give 24 bits. And same way we divide the IP address into two parts here also. Network ID and the host ID. We give 16 bits to network ID and 16 bits to the host ID. In the same way, we divide IP address in two parts, the network ID and the host ID. And we give 24 to this and 16 and 8 bits to host ID. Okay. And for identification purpose, first bit is reserved so that we get to know it belongs to class A. For class B, two bits are reserved, 10. Then it's left 7 bits for host ID. If we give 10 to this, then how many bits are left for network ID? 14. And here is 110. So how many? 24 minus 3 is 21 bits for the network ID. Okay. So this is how we classify, you know, IP addresses into different classes, and this is how we divide the IP address into two parts. Okay. So this is the IP address 190.255.254.254. Now you can see that 190 is in the range of 128 to 191. So this belongs to the class B. You can easily take the correct options if you remember this table. Okay. Now question number 18. In hierarchical routing with 4800 routers, what region and cluster sizes should be chosen to minimize the size of the routing table for a three-layer hierarchy? Okay. Now let's talk about first hierarchical routing. Okay. So we know that the network grows, when the network grows in size, so for that routing table is also runs proportionally, and for that we need more memory size. So that's why we need hierarchical routing, so that we can easily manage it. Now the thing is, let's suppose we divide the routers into different regions. So there's some this is a space and we divide it into different regions. This is a region number 1. This is a region number 2. This is a region number 3. And this is the region number 4. And in between some clusters are there. Some routers are there. So these routers are connected with each other. Now assume that there is a one A cluster, there is a B regions, and there is C clusters per region, right? Now there is a formula to minimize it, because we want to minimize the size of routing table for three layer hierarchy. Okay, so there is three layer hierarchy, means that we have region, then we divide the region into, you know, different small clusters, and then cluster to zone, and then zone to group. So this is the hierarchy. कि first हमने region के अंदर इसको divide किया, फिर हमने छोटे-छोटे clusters के अंदर इनको divide किया, फिर उसके अंदर clusters के कभी हमने small part किया zone में, then we divide into group like this, right? So this is the complexity complexity of the network. Okay, now so we want to minimize the size of the routing table for a three level hierarchy, means from region to clusters, and then we go to the router, directly go to the router. So this is a three level hierarchy. Now to minimize that the routing table, we have one formula. The formula is A minus B. I'm writing here cluster minus 1 plus region minus 1 plus routers. Okay, now we have in the options values are there, so just put all the values one by one in this formula, and when you get the minimum value among the four, that will be the correct answer. Let's suppose the cluster value is 15. So 15 minus 1 plus region minus 16 is the region, minus 1 plus router is 20. So 15 minus 1 is 14, 16 minus 1 is 15 plus 20. So in total, this is 5 plus 4 is 9, and 3 plus 1 3, and plus 1 is 4. This is the 49. In the same way, put all the values in this formula. So this is going to be 16 minus 1 plus 12 minus 1 plus 25. This is going to be 15 plus 11 plus 25. So the answer is 6 plus 5 is 11. This is 3 plus 1 is 4 plus 5. Now in the same way, you can find for this and for this, among them which one is smaller, you can tick on that particular option. Okay, so for that you just remind this formula. If this type of question comes, cluster minus 1 plus region minus 1, and then add the number of routers present in the network. Okay, and this is the three level hierarchy, means first we got this network, we go to the region, then we go to the router, then we reach to the routers. Okay, question number 19 is, in IPv4 header, which field is needed to allow the destination host to determine which datagram a newly arrived fragment belongs to? So first I draw some rough diagram of IPv4 header, then I will explain you all the identification, fragment offset, time to leave, and header checksum functionality. Okay, so this is the header, IPv4 header. So the first layer, in the first layer, version is there, header length. Second one, third one is type of service. I'm just writing this TOS, type of service, short form, and this is a total length. In the second layer, identification is there. And some flags, okay, like don't fragment, more fragment, like this, and fragment offset is there, fragment offset. Now in the next layer, TTL, time to live, protocol, and header checksum. In the third layer, header, checksum. In the next is source IP address 32 bits, destination IP address, and the last is options. Okay, now for the version, we gave 4 bits. For header length, we gave 4 bits. Time to lay, type of service, for we gave 8 bits. And for time, total length, we gave 16 bits. Okay. For identification also, we give 16 bits. And for fragment offset, we give 13. Time to leave, Kelly, 8 bits. And for header checksum also 16. And this is 32 bits. Right, and 0 to 40 bytes are given to the options field. Okay, so this is the rough diagram. This is the diagram for IPv4 header. Now I'm going to explain you what is the functionality of identification. Fragment offset is here, time to live is here, and header checksum is here, one by one. And then we've come back to the question. Now we have, let's suppose we have two networks. This is a network number one, and this is the network number two. Okay. The maximum transferable unit for this is 520, and the maximum transferable unit for this is 200. Okay. And I'm going to send some frame, some packet from this packet, from this network to this network. Okay. Now this fragment, the maximum transferable unit for this is 520. It means 20 for header, and the 500 units are here. But are this packet is able to enter in this network? No, because the maximum transferable unit is 200 only, and we are giving 500. So that's why we are going to divide this packet into different parts. Or agar jab hum is frame ko, or you can say this packet ko jab hum divide karte to usse hum kehte hain fragmentation. We have fragments, matlab humne fragments divide, humne division kar diya apne packets ka different parts mein. Ab part mein kaise hoga? हमने 180, let's suppose 200 इसकी maximum transferable unit है, तो मैंने क्या किया, 20 header को दिया, 180 मैंने transfer किया, same भी 180 से दिया, and 20 header में रखा, right? So this is going to be, and there is one more fragment, मैंने एक और fragment को इसमें रखा, right? यहाँ पर हमने क्या किया, fragmentation की, because maximum transferable unit receiver side pe 200 thi, and we are not able to, this packet is not able to enter in that particular network. That's why I fragment the packet. Now abhi ye fragment yahan ye network, is network se hoke ye is network pe jab jayega, and this is the receiver, right? Yahan par receiver hai. How receiver will able to identify, please listen carefully, how receiver yahan par hai. This is the receiver. Okay. How receiver able to identify all these packets are coming from the same, same source. यहाँ पर ये source है. इस source ने ये packet से send करना था, but उसने उसे fragment में कर दिया ताकि वो इस network के अंदर से enter हो सके. Now receiver को कैसे पता लगे? Because यहाँ पर ये इसने fragment किया है, और भी number of packets are there, जो कि यहाँ पर same networks में आ रहे हैं. सेम सिस्टम के पास आए. हाउ दिस रिसीवर गेट टू नो कि ये तीनों जो पैकेट्स हैं कमिंग फ्रॉम द सेम सोर्स. फॉर दैट पर्पस वी नीड आइडेंटिफिकेशन नंबर. ओके, सो आइडेंटिफिकेशन नंबर क्या बताएगा? इट आइडेंटिफाई ऑल थ्री फ्रेगमेंट्स आर कमिंग फ्रॉम द सेम डेटाग्राम. आई एम राइटिंग हियर विद द हेल्प ऑफ आइडेंटिफिकेशन नंबर. I'm writing here with the help of identification number. Receiver get to know that all three fragments coming from the same source, or you can say same datagram. So that's why we need identification number. अब मैं क्या करूँगी कि ये इस datagram का identification number है 100, तो इसका भी 100 होगा, इसका भी 100 होगा, और इसका भी identification number is 100. So it means that the parent is 100 and they are the child of the 100 parent. Okay. This is the meaning. तो identification number इस केस में 100 हुआ. अगर सबका identification number 100 है, तो we get to know, okay, एक source था 100, उसके ये three क्या है, हमारे fragments है, okay, and these three fragments are belonging to the same datagram. The number is 100. So this is the functionality of identification number. Now the next one is fragment offset. A fragment offset kya hai? A fragment offset means that agar mere paas 500 bits thi, और मैंने उसे फिर डिवाइड किया, तो फर्स्ट मैंने क्या किया, 1 to 200 बिट्स मैंने फर्स्ट फ्रेगमेंट को पास की, उसके अंदर डाली फर्स्ट फ्रेगमेंट में, फिर नेक्स्ट 201 से लेके मैंने नेक्स्ट मैंने उसके अंदर डाली नेक्स्ट फ्रेगमेंट में, फिर नेक्स्ट टू नेक्स्ट मैंने थर्ड फ्रेगमेंट में डाली. तो फर्स्ट 1 to 200 फ्रेगमेंट्स मेरी फ्रेगमेंट नंबर 1 में. अब क्या है कि येस वी गेट टू नो दैट ऑल द फ्रेगमेंट्स बिलोंग टू द सेम सोर्स, बट कौन सा फ्रेगमेंट फर्स्ट 200 बिट्स को कंटेन कर रहा है, कौन सा मिड 200 बिट्स को कवर कर रहा है, कौन सा लास्ट की बिट्स को कवर कर रहा है, तो उससे हमें कैसे पता लगेगा, वो हमें पता लगेगा विद द हेल्प ऑफ फ्रेगमेंट ऑफसेट. सो फ्रेगमेंट ऑफसेट बेसिकली यूज्ड टू आइडेंटिफाई the order to which these fragments comes. Let's suppose this fragment number is first, मतलब first 200 bits इसके अंदर है, next 200 bits इस fragment के अंदर और next fragment इसके अंदर, so that he is able to arrange them when these three fragments are received by this receiver, then it is able to arrange which comes which comes before which comes after that particular fragments. So to convert the out of order sequence of the fragments, it convert it into the in order sequence. So uski functionality kya hai ki jo out of order sequence hai fragments ki, out of order sequence hai, use wo in order sequence mein convert kar deta hai. So this is the functionality of the fragment offset. Now let's talk about the time to live and header checksum. Now, time to live functionality is, let's suppose if this is the frame and the time to live number is 2, okay, and somewhere some receiver is present, okay. Now, in between some routers are there, some hops are present in between them, in between the source and the destination. Let's suppose this is India, okay. And this is let's suppose this is Delhi. Now Delhi to we move to Mumbai, we have to pass the Delhi from Mumbai, so in between first Rajasthan come, then Gujarat come, and then Mumbai come, right? So now that when this frame is reached at this point, the value is going to be decreased to 1, so the time to live value is 1. Now the frame is reached to Gujarat, the value is going to be TTL value is going to be 0, okay. Now the TTL value is now 0, time to live value is 0, so now this packet is going to be discarded, okay. If we not given this time to live value, so in that case it goes into the infinite loop, it will not able to reach that particular host, okay. So this is a functionality of the time to live. We are get to know that the time to live value is 0, so we are going to discard this message, okay. So this is a functionality, and header checksum basically used to verify the header only. Now come back to our question, in IPv4 header, which field is needed to allow the destination what to determine which datagram a newly arrived fragments belongs to, matlab ki jo newly arrived fragments hai ye kis datagram se belong karte hai, ye kaun hame batata hai, identification number jo ki 16 bit ka hota hai, okay. Ye to maine just for example aapko diya hai ki 100, but identification number 16 bit ka hota hai. So right answer is option number A for identification, okay. Now let's come to the question number 20. A relation R, so these are the attributes A, B, C, D, E, F, G, is given the following set of functional dependencies. So functional dependencies are there, 1, 2, 3, 4. Four functional dependencies are here. So I'm just writing here, FD implies E, BE implies F, B implies C, AF implies G. Okay. Now you can see that we can derive E. We can derive E. So it should not be a candidate key. We have to find out the candidate key. Okay. So it's cancel out because we can able to derive E na. So we cut E from here. F, B, E derive F. So F should not be a candidate key. This F attribute is not in a candidate key. C is also, we are able to derive it, and G we also derive it. Now the left attributes are A, B and D. So these three attributes we are not able to derive with the help of some functional dependencies. So that's why A, B, D is the candidate key. And you can see that A derives, with the help of this we can derive all the attributes, like, right? So with the help of B we derive C, with the help of AD we derive E, right? Now so A, B, D is here, right? So with the help of B we derive F, and with the help of A and F we derive G. So this is the candidate key, and with the help of this we are going to derive all the attributes, right? So A, B, D is the candidate key. Now question number 42 is, what will be the hexadecimal value in the register AX 32 bit? Koi register hai AX, theek hai, uski 32 bits hai after executing the following instructions, theek hai. So उसकी जो लोअर बिट है AL, उसके अंदर क्या स्टोर है, AL के अंदर क्या स्टोर है, 50. सो इट्स गोइंग टू बी लाइक दिस, एंड ए मूव AH, हम दिस वैल्यू AL के अंदर मूव किया हमने, एंड देन AH के अंदर हमने फिर से 15 मूव किया. सो इट्स गोइंग टू बी लाइक दिस, ठीक है, एंड XOR किया AL विद AL. अगर हम सेम वैल्यू को सेम वैल्यू के साथ एक्सोर करते हैं तो वी गॉट आंसर जीरो, क्योंकि एक्सोर की अगर मैं टेबल की बात करूं तो 0001 1011. सो दिस इज ए एंड दिस इज बी, और मुझे अगर ए एक्सोर बी करना है तो अगर वैल्यू सेम है वी गॉट जीरो, अगर वैल्यूज डिफरेंट है ए एंड बी की तो वी गॉट वन. सो अगर मैं ए एन एंड ए एल, अगर इसको ए एल को सेम उसी नंबर से एक्सोर करते हैं वी गॉट ओनली जीरो, राइट. सो अब ए एल के अंदर क्या स्टोर हो जाएगा, जीरो. तो जो ये वैल्यू 0011 थी तो ये भी क्या हो जाएंगी, जीरो, लाइक दिस. ओके, सो दिस इज ओवर, दिस इंस्ट्रक्शन इज ओवर, दिस इंस्ट्रक्शन इज ओवर. अब ये क्या कह रहा है, मूव सीएल के अंदर वी हैव टू पुट 3. ओके, एंड द नेक्स्ट इंस्ट्रक्शन इज शिफ्ट राइट AX, और उसको कितना शिफ्ट करना है, राइट 3. सीएल वैल्यू इज 3 ना, सो शिफ्ट राइट. So the meaning of this instruction is used, this instruction basically used to shift bits towards right side, and we are putting zeros in the most, in the MSPs, right? So when we shift right all this AX bits, so it's going to be, so the final it's going to be 0000, and this will become 0111. And this will become 1000, and this is 000. So this is 0. This is 8 for 12 plus 2 14. So 14 represented by E, 1 and 0. So this is the answer, which is in a hexadecimal form. So option 3 is the right one. Now question number 43. Which of the following statement is false? So the first statement is top down parsers are LL parsers, where L stand for left to right scan, and the second L stand for the leftmost derivation. So this statement is absolutely right. Now the next one is, let's discuss first this third statement. Bottom up parsers are in the LR family, where L, this L represent left to right scan, and this R represent the rightmost derivations. This is also true. फोर्थ स्टेटमेंट क्या कहती है कि द क्लास ऑफ कॉन्टेक्स्ट फ्री लैंग्वेज इज क्लोज अंडर रिवर्सल. यस इट इज क्लोज अंडर रिवर्सल. कॉन्टेक्स्ट फ्री लैंग्वेज इज नॉट क्लोज अंडर द इंटरसेक्शन एंड द कॉम्प्लीमेंटेशन. राइट दैट इज इफ एल इज एनी कॉन्टेक्स्ट फ्री लैंग्वेज देन एल आर इज द कॉन्टेक्स्ट द रिवर्स इज ऑल्सो द कॉन्टेक्स्ट फ्री लैंग्वेज. दिस इज ट्रू. So the left out statement is 43, which is false. Now just read the statement. So this is a regular expression that matches only strings containing an odd number of zeros, including the empty string. So it's not like this. We are getting always odd number of you can say odd number of zeros. So the strings like is also possible. You can put as many as zeros in this regular expression. So this statement is false. Right now question number 38 is the in order traversal of the following tree is what. As you know that we have three types of traversing of tree. The first one is pre-order, second one is in order, and the third type of traversing is post order. Right, so in order mein hum kya karte hain, first we print root node, then we go left subtree. I'm writing the short form left subtree, and then we go to the right subtree. Okay, for in order means first we go to the left subtree, print it, then we print root, and then we go to the right subtree. Okay, and for the post order, first we go to left subtree, then we go to the right subtree, and at last we print the root. But in the question they are asking about in order traversal, so we are going to focus on this part only, right? So in according to this traversing, in order traversing, first we go to the left subtree. You know that this is our left subtree. This is our left subtree, and this is our right subtree. Okay, for this node, for this root node. Okay, now we start our traversing from this root node. So this is the in order traversal. So first we go to the left subtree here. Now I'm at this node is a root node is a root node, and this one is the left subtree, and this is the right subtree. Okay, then again I'm going to the left subtree. Right now I'm at here there is left child and there is right child. So according to the in order traversal, I have to go to the left subtree. Right now I'm at here, there is no left, there is no right. If there is no left, there is no right, then I'm going to print the root node. So the root node is 2, so I'm going to print 2. Okay, so it finished. Now I'm going back. So this is 4, so left subtree is over. Now after left subtree, I'm going to print the root. So the root for this is 4. So I'm going to print 4. And after printing root, I'm going to the left right subtree. So the right subtree, only one node is there. So I'm going to print 3. Now you can see that second and third options are already printed, is already eliminated. When we saw that first left subtree should be printed, and 2 is there. And in the next session, they are saying that first right subtree should be printed. But right subtree is printed when there is a post order traversal. But in the in order traversal, I'm going to print first root, then right subtree. Okay, so option first is the right answer. Now, just complete it. Now I'm at here. Okay, this is complete. So left subtree is completed for this root node. Right, so agar ye left subtree complete ho gaya to ab hum kya karenge, left subtree completion hone ke baad hum kya print karte hain, root. So root kya hai, 13. Right, देन वी गो टू द राइट सबट्री. अब राइट सबट्री में हम यहाँ गए तो हमने देखा कि इस नोड का देर इज नो लेफ्ट सबट्री. ठीक है, लेफ्ट सबट्री नहीं है तो देन वी आर नेक्स्ट टास्क इज टू प्रिंट द रूट. सो प्रिंट रूट इज 7, राइट, एंड देन वी गो टू द राइट सबट्री. राइट सबट्री मीन्स देर इज ओनली वन नोड, सो वी आर गोइंग टू प्रिंट 6. ओके, नाउ यू कैन सी दैट this is over, this is over, this is over. Okay, so for this node left subtree is already printed. So I'm if left subtree is printed, then I'm going to print my root node and then I go to the right subtree. Ab main right subtree mein gayi traverse karte hue to mujhe ye root node mili jiske do child hai, ek left subtree ek right subtree hai. To agar in order hai to main left subtree के पास पहले जाऊंगी और मैंने देखा कि यहाँ पर एक नोड है जो कि रूट नोड है. देर इज नो लेफ्ट, देर इज नो राइट चाइल्ड, सो डायरेक्टली आई एम गोइंग टू प्रिंट 17. देन आई गो बैक, सो 20 इज द रूट नोड जिसका लेफ्ट सबट्री ऑलरेडी प्रिंटेड. द नेक्स्ट टास्क इज टू प्रिंट द रूट. नाउ आई एम गोइंग टू द राइट सबट्री. नाउ एट दिस, so this is a root node, right, जिसका left subtree है and there is no right subtree. So left subtree is 18, so I'm going to print it. Then I print 18 as a root node and there is no right subtree, so I'm not going to print anything. So this is my answer. This is an order traversal, how I'm going to traverse each node one by one. So 1 is not the right answer, 4 is the right answer. 2, 4, 3, 13, 7, 6, 15, 17, 20, 18 and 18. Okay, so option 4 is the right answer. Now, question number 39. An ideal sort is an in-place sort. In-place sort whose additional space required is how much? So if we divide it into the two parts, so first is in place algorithm and the second one is outplace algorithm. ठीक है, in place and outplace algorithm में क्या difference और ये कितना space required करती है, right? You have already studied merge sort, जिसके अंदर क्या होता है कि एक array होता है, उस arrays को हम टू पार्ट्स में डिवाइड करते हैं जो ऑलरेडी सॉर्टेड है एंड देन वी यू नो देन वी अप्लाई सम कंप्यूटेशन एंड वी यू नो कॉपी ऑल द एलिमेंट्स, राइट. सो इन दिस केस, इन दिस एल्गोरिथम वी नीड एक्स्ट्रा स्पेस सो दैट वी सॉल्व देम इंडिपेंडेंटली, बिकॉज मर्ज सॉर्ट में क्या होता है कि कुछ पार्ट 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 दिस पार्ट इज ऑलरेडी सॉर्टेड एंड 8, 9, 10 इन रिवर्स ऑर्डर 10, 9, 8, 7, 6 like this. So this part is sorted, this part is sorted. So we do is like we copy all the elements in this array, we copy all the elements in this array, we do some computation and then we combine these two elements in the one array, right? So for that, for this kind of algorithm, we need extra space ताकि हम computation कर सके. अगर हमें extra space की जरूरत है तो उसको हम कहेंगे outplace algorithm. Because we are copying all the elements out of their places and then solving them back, right? So, उस केस में हमें जो time complexity है वो हमारी order of n लगी, क्योंकि जितने number of n elements होंगे उतना ही तो space हमें चाहिए होगा दोबारा copy करने के लिए, right? अगर in place algorithm है कि हमें कोई extra space नहीं चाहिए, हम सिर्फ उस array में रह के ही हम we are doing computation, उसे हम in place algorithm कहते हैं. उस केस में order of one रहता है time space complexity, right? So they are talking about the in place sort whose additional space required is order of one, constant. Now let's talk about question number 23. 4 channels are multiplexed using TDM. If each channel sends 100 byte per second and we multiplex 1 byte per channel, then the bit rate for the link is what? Right, so I'm writing here bit rate of the link or for the link is how many number of channels are here? 4. and each channel sends 100 byte per second, right? So 4 into 100 bytes per second, okay? And this answer in bits per second, so we are going to convert it. So this is going to be 4 into 100 into 8. So this is just a very simple question. 4 into 100 into 8, and this is going to be bits per second. And this is 400 into 8 is 3200 BPS. Okay, so option 4 is the right one. Now, question number 40. Which of the following is not a conjunction policy at network layer? The first one is flow control policy. Second one is packet discard policy. Third is packet lifetime management policy. And the fourth one is routing algorithm. So the first one is flow control policy. Flow control policy, basically it is a function of data link layer and the transport layer. It is not a function of the network layer. A flow control policy mein hota kya hai? Flow control policy kya hai ki, let's suppose this is your client and this is the receiver. Okay, ye sender hai, ye receiver hai. Ab kya ho raha hai ki yahan par receiver ke paas ek buffer hota hai, right? अब सेंडर क्या कर रहा है, ट्रांसमिशन चैनल से पैकेट्स कंटिन्यूअसली पैकेट्स सेंड कर रहा है, ओके? एंड यहां पर क्या हो रहा है कि जो इसकी इसकी जो सेंडिंग स्पीड है इज यू नो इज ग्रेटर देन द स्पीड ऑफ द प्रोसेसिंग, ताकि वो रिसीवर उनको प्रोसेस कर सके. अब यहां क्या होता है कि ये जो पैकेट्स हैं यहां इस बफर में आ जाते हैं, बट वो प्रोसेस होकर यहाँ जा रहे हैं, बट उनकी स्पीड बहुत कम है एज कम्पेयर टू जो वो पैकेट्स यहाँ से आ रहे हैं जो सेंडर सेंड कर रहा है. सो इन दिस केस तो यहाँ क्या होगा कि यहाँ बफर में ओवरफ्लो हो जाएगा, ओके? इफ द डेटाग्राम्स आर रिसीव्ड मच फास्टर देन दे आर फॉरवर्डेड और यू कैन से प्रोसेस्ड बाय द रिसीवर, इट मे कॉज ओवरफ्लो. ओके, सो इन दिस केस हम क्या करेंगे, इन दिस केस हम डिस्कार्ड करेंगे, या तो इस केस में हम क्या रहेगा कि हम डिस्कार्ड करने लग जाएंगे डेटाग्राम्स को, कि जो लेट्स सपोज अगर यहाँ पर बफर ही फिल हो गया तो बाकी जो पैकेट सारे उनको हम क्या कर रहे हैं, डिस्कार्ड कर रहे हैं. ओके, सो ये क्या है, फ्लो कंट्रोल पॉलिसी है कि हमें कैसे कंट्रोल करना है अपने इस इनफ्लो ऑफ पैकेट्स को, राइट? सो उनको कंट्रोल करने के लिए डेटा लिंक लेयर एंड ट्रांसपोर्ट लेयर वर्क, डेटा लिंक लेयर एंड ट्रांसपोर्ट लेयर वर्क्स ऑन द फ्लो कंट्रोल पॉलिसी, ठीक है? सो नेक्स्ट है पैकेट डिस्कार्ड पॉलिसी. पैकेट डिस्कार्ड पॉलिसी नेटवर्क लेयर यूज करती है. उस कैसे यूज करती है और क्यों यूज करती है, जैसे कि व्हेन राउटर कैनॉट राउट द डेटाग्राम, कि जैसे ये सेंडर है, ये रिसीवर है, और इस ट्रांसमिशन चैनल्स में कुछ राउटर्स लगे हुए हैं, राइट? अब इस पर्टिकुलर राउटर के पास आकर जो ये डेटाग्राम यहाँ आया, एंड दिस राउटर इज नॉट एबल टू राउट दिस डेटाग्राम, आगे का रास्ता वो नहीं बता पा रहा. सो इन दिस केस वो क्या करेगा, इन दिस केस द डेटाग्राम इज डिस्कार्डेड एंड द डेस्टिनेशन होस्ट सेंड्स अ डेस्टिनेशन अनरीचेबल मैसेज. ओके, तो वो उसको क्या करेगा, डिस्कार्ड करेगा, और उस केस में डेस्टिनेशन जो होस्ट है वो सेंड करेगा डेस्टिनेशन अनरीचेबल मैसेज. सो उस केस में हम डिस्कार्ड कर देते हैं पैकेट्स को. तो नेक्स्ट वन इज पैकेट लाइफ टाइम मैनेजमेंट पॉलिसी. सो व्हेन द डेटाग्राम विजिट एनी राउटर, लाइक दिस डेटाग्राम विजिट दिस राउटर, तो उसका जो टाइम टू लिव वैल्यू होगी वो डिक्रीमेंट बाय वन, एक एक करके वो क्या होगी, डिक्रीमेंट होती रहेगी. तो इस केस में क्या रहेगा, अगर हम इसको टाइम टू लिव एक वैल्यू प्रोवाइड करेंगे, लेट्स सपोज अगर मैंने इसको टाइम टू लिव वैल्यू प्रोवाइड की 5, यहाँ इस राउटर पे वो पहुंची तो वैल्यू विल बिकम डिक्रीज बाय 1, देन 3, देन 2, देन 1, राइट? एंड देन यहाँ पर डेस्टिनेशन पहुंचने के बाद इट बिकम 0. सो लेट्स सपोज अगर वैल्यू यहाँ होती 4, तो वो यहीं पर ही जीरो हो जाती, एंड वैल्यू एंड क्या रहता है कि वहाँ पर वो पैकेट को डिस्कार्ड कर देता. ऐसा नहीं होता कि वो अगर उसको डेस्टिनेशन नहीं मिल रहा तो वो लूप में चली जाती, राइट? बट इस केस में अगर टाइम टू लिव की वैल्यू अगर लेस हो गई है, जीरो हो गई है, तो हम उसी टाइम उस पैकेट को डिस्कार्ड कर देंगे. तो उससे क्या रहेगा, हम पैकेट की लाइफ टाइम मैनेजमेंट कर रहे हैं इन द नेटवर्क लेयर. Now the next one is routing algorithm. You know different routing algorithm we have already studied, like distance vector routing, link state routing algorithm and all in the network layer. So option first is the right one because it is a functionality of data link layer and the transport layer, not the network layer. Now the question number 41 is loop unrolling is an optimization technique. Option number one is that avoid test at every iteration of the loop. Second is that improves performance by decreasing the number of instruction in a basic block. Third is the exchanges inner loop with outer loops. And the third and the fourth one is the reorders operations to allow multiple computations to happen in parallel. Okay. So I'm writing here what is the loop unrolling in a code optimization technique. So loop unrolling kya karta hai? Loop unrolling basically it avoids test cases, or you can say it avoids test cases at every iteration of the loop, or you can say it decreasing the number of test cases. ठीक है. So the option number one is that avoid test cases at every iteration of the loop is the right answer. Now question number 21. Which of the following services is not provided by wireless access point in 802.11 WLAN? This is a wireless LAN, right? So the first one is association. Second is deassociation. Third one is error correction and the fourth one is integration. So let's discuss about the 802.11 and about their services. Then we'll come back to our question. So this wireless LAN, basically it's the world's most widely used wireless computer networking standards. We use this in our homes, in our offices, to allow laptops, to allow your smartphones to talk to each other, or you can say communicate with each other, and it accesses the internet without the help of any cables or wires, right? So now I'm just drawing one diagram. So let's suppose this is your distributed system, right? If this is the distributed system, then let's suppose two laptops wants to communicate with each other, right? And there is one access point is here. With the help of access point, they are able to communicate with each other. And this is going to be one basic service set. So this is BSS, okay? And there is also one BSS is here also. And let's suppose three stations are here, and there is one access point is also there for this BSS 2, basic service set 2, right? Now let's talk about the services. This is the station. They are stations. So if these two stations want to communicate with each other, it's communicate with the ad hoc, or you can say IBSS. IBSS basically it's an independent basic service set, right? And if these two wants to communicate because they are located at different BSS, so when two BSS wants to communicate with each other, so they are communicate with the help of distributed system, okay? Now let's talk about the services of, I'm writing here, let's talk about services of 802.11 WLAN, right? This is wireless LAN. This is the basic diagram, how this is distributed system is connected with this BSS, right? Now let's talk about services. अब सर्विसेज में क्या है कि सर्विसेज आर ऑफ टू टाइप्स, स्टेशन सर्विसेज एंड द सेकंड वन इज डिस्ट्रीब्यूटेड सिस्टम सर्विस. right? So if we talk about the station services, so they and the station service were provided different services. The first one is authentication. We provide the authentication before establishing a connection when we communicate with another station. And the authentication is further divided into two parts. The first one is open system authentication, and the second one is shared key authentication. Open system authentication kya hai ki basically it's a default method for authentication. It's very simple and it's a two-step process. This open system authentication is a two-step process. First step is, in the first step, the sender stations sends a frame to the receiver, right, in which some informations of sender station's identity is there. And after getting the frames, the receiver send you for the acknowledgement purpose frame sent back to the sender, right? So this is a two-step process. And the next one is shared key. So in the shared key, user already registered, those users who are already registered, they have a shared key, and with the help of shared key they are able to access the point, right? So this is the difference between open system and shared key. Now the next one is deauthentication. Ab deauthentication kya hai? Deauthentication means hai ki agar user paas ek access point hai to use jo jab wo terminate karta hai connection ko, to this will be called a deauthentication. Now the next one is privacy. So this privacy service is also provided by the station. And the next one is MAC service data unit. MAC service data unit mein kya hota hai ki it ensures that data delivered successfully or not. Sender se receiver tak data successfully receive hua hai ya nahi, this will take care by MAC service data unit. Okay, so this is all about the station services. Jo stations provide karta hai jo services. Ab baat karte hain ki distributed system kya kya services provide karta hai, right? So the first one is association. In the association means that any user, whether it's associated with any specific access point or not, right? So the next one is reassociation. In the reassociation, it means that when the user move from one access point to another access point, then reassociation service is in used. Now the next one is deassociation. Deassociation means when we want to terminate the connection for that particular access point. So in that case, we want this service deassociation. And there is one more services, distribution. Distribution mein kya hota hai ki one access point to another access point tak jab hum data ko distribute karte hain, to this service is provided by distributions. This is the service of distribution, right? And there is one more service is integration. So integration mein basically it enables the delivery of MAC frames. So these are the services provided by the distributed system, and these are the services which is provided by the stations, right? Authentication, authenticate any user. Deauthentications may be terminate the access point. Privacy provide karna. MAC service data unit, in which we ensure that data is successfully delivered or not. Associate करना, reassociation करना जब हम move कर रहे हैं, deassociation जब हम terminate करना चाहते हैं, distribution means one access point से दूसरे access point पे हम जब distribute करते हैं data, and the integration, right? So these are the services. Now let's come back to the question. Question number 21. Which of the following services is not provided by wireless access point? So association is these are the services of distributed system, not station. So association is also provided. Deassociation जब हम terminate करते हैं is also provided. Integration is also provided. So error correction is not provided this service is not provided. So option third is the right one. Okay. So now question number 22 is, which of the field in IPv4 datagram is not related to fragmentation? So let's talk about fragmentation first. जब हम फ्रेगमेंट करते हैं किसी भी पैकेट को तो हमें क्या क्या न्यू सर्विसेज की हमें ज़रूरत पड़ती है. सो दैट कि जब हमने कोई पैकेट को अगर हमने फ्रेगमेंट किया, लेट सपोज दिस इज़ द वन नेटवर्क एंड दिस इज़ द अनदर नेटवर्क. MTU का मतलब होता है मैक्सिमम ट्रांसफरेबल यूनिट. फॉर दिस नेटवर्क, दिस इज़ द नेटवर्क ए एंड दिस इज़ द नेटवर्क बी. नेटवर्क ए की मैक्सिमम ट्रांसफरेबल यूनिट है 520, ओके. एंड मैक्सिमम ट्रांसफरेबल यूनिट फॉर नेटवर्क बी इज 200 बाइट्स, राइट. नाउ हमारा जो पैकेट है, हमारा पैकेट में 20 बाइट फॉर हेडर एंड 500 इज फॉर द डेटा पार्ट, राइट. सो this is the whole datagram and there is one route, there is router in between these networks, in these two networks. Now maximum transferable unit for this network is 520, but for this network is 200 only. How we are going to pull that much of data into this network, okay. So that's why we need fragmentations. Itne zyada data ko we are not able to enter this, that much of data is not able to enter in this network. That's why we need fragmentation. Fragmentation matlab bade packet ko chote chote parts mein divide kar dena taki wo network mein se pass ho sake. So isliye hum kya kehte hain, us cheez ko hum kya kehte hain ki mapping or fragmentation, ki hum divide kar rahe hain packet ko into different, into small 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 fragments. Ab jaise ye hai, इस पैकेट को हमें डिवाइड करना है डिफरेंट पैकेट्स में, तो इसकी हम डिवीजन होंगी, इसके जो फ्रेगमेंट्स बनेंगे वो तीन फ्रेगमेंट्स बनेंगे. फ्रेगमेंट नंबर वन, फ्रेगमेंट नंबर टू एंड दिस इज फ्रेगमेंट नंबर थ्री, राइट. इस फ्रेगमेंट में फर्स्ट फ्रेगमेंट के अंदर 180 बाइट जाएगी एंड 20 इसमें, क्योंकि 200 मैक्सिमम ट्रांसफरेबल यूनिट. अब 20 तो मैंने अपने हेडर को दिया, तो बाकी कितना बचा 180. 200 में टोटल ही सेंड कर सकती हूँ, तो उसमें मैंने क्या किया 20 बाइट्स दिए अपने हेडर को और बाकी 180 मैंने डेटा सेंड किया. अब बाकी नेक्स्ट 180 मैं इसके साथ नेक्स्ट फ्रेगमेंट में दे दूंगी और 20 बाइट में दूंगी अपने हेडर को, एंड फिर जो लेफ्ट जितनी भी बाइट्स रह जाएगी 140 बाइट्स को मैं अपने डेटा को दूंगी और मैं उसमें से एंटर करवाऊंगी. तो हमें तीन फ्रेगमेंट्स की ज़रूरत है अगर मुझे इस पैकेट को एंटर करवाना है इस नेटवर्क के अंदर. Okay, so all three fragments contain headers because it is a datagram service. So they go independently these are the fragments, three fragments. So they go independently. That's why we need the header. Now, अब क्या है कि यहाँ पर क्या है कि network का, let's suppose इस network का क्या है, यहाँ पर buffer है. Okay. क्या हुआ कि देर आर सो मैनी नंबर ऑफ पैकेट, सेंडर्स भी बहुत ज़्यादा होंगे. इस सेंडर ने इस ये पैकेट को सेंड किया, लेट सपोज इस सेंडर ने कोई और पैकेट सेंड किया, तो बहुत सारे पैकेट्स हैं जो कि लाइंस में आ रहे हैं. तो लेट सपोज पहले क्या उसे क्या इस बफर में उसे सबसे पहले कौन सा पैकेट आया, क्योंकि ये इंडिपेंडेंटली एक चैनल में जा रहे हैं, राइट. सो देर इज़ अ पॉसिबिलिटी कि फ्रेगमेंट वन पहले आए या फ्रेगमेंट टू पहले आए, तो देर इज़ अ पॉसिबिलिटी. लेट सपोज पहले फ्रेगमेंट नंबर टू आया, फिर फ्रेगमेंट नंबर वन आया एंड फिर फ्रेगमेंट नंबर थ्री आया, ओके. एंड नथिंग इज मेंशन्ड, जस्ट 20 एंड 180 डिवीजन इज हियर, राइट. एंड 20 एंड 180 डिवीजन इज हियर, 20 एंड 140 डिवीजन इज हियर फॉर दिस पैकेट, ओके. एंड दिस इज रिसीवर, दिस नेटवर्क इज रिसीवर. नाउ टेल मी हाउ दिस रिसीवर able to identify that all three fragments are coming from the same datagram. उसे कैसे पता लगेगा कि, क्योंकि वो अलग अलग टाइम पे उस रिसीवर नेटवर्क के पास पहुँचे हैं, तो रिसीवर को कैसे पता लगेगा कि ये जो तीनों फ्रेगमेंट्स हैं ये सेम डेटाग्राम को सेम डेटाग्राम से ही डिवाइड हुए हैं, और यू कैन से कमिंग फ्रॉम द सेम डेटाग्राम, राइट. तो उसके लिए वी वॉन्ट कि हम उसे कोई नंबरिंग दें. लेट्स सपोज मैंने इस सॉरी नेक्स्ट वन या लेट्स सपोज द नंबर ऑफ दिस डेटाग्राम इज 100. ओके सो दिस इज द पेरेंट एंड द चिल्ड्रंस आर फ्रेगमेंट 1, फ्रेगमेंट 2 एंड फ्रेगमेंट 3. ओके सो इनका भी नंबर क्या होना चाहिए? 100 100 100. So that we the receiver is able to identify that these fragments are coming from the same source. So agar inka identification, so ye jo number hota hai na, is number ko hum kehte hain identification number. Identification number, identification number as a name suggests, identify karne ke liye ki wo same source se aa rahe hain ya nahi aa rahe. To iska bhi आइडेंटिफिकेशन नंबर 100 है, इसका भी आइडेंटिफिकेशन 100 है, इसका भी आइडेंटिफिकेशन 100 है. अगर इन तीनों का ही आइडेंटिफिकेशन 100 है, देन रिसीवर गेट टू नो ओके दे आर कमिंग फ्रॉम द सेम सोर्स. सो ये क्या है कि कोई पैकेट है जो कि काफ़ी बड़े साइज का है और वो इस नेटवर्क में आ नहीं पा रहा. दैट्स वाई सेंडर ने क्या किया, उसे फ्रेगमेंट किया और ये एक ही, अगर मैं इसे यू नो एक साथ रखूँ तो ये एक पैकेट को रिप्रेजेंट करते हैं. ओके सो फ्रेगमेंट टेशन के लिए आइडेंटिफिकेशन नंबर तो बहुत ज़्यादा ज़रूरी है कि ये पता करने के लिए आई एम राइटिंग हेयर आइडेंटिटीफाई करने के लिए ऑल थ्री फ्रेगमेंट्स आर कमिंग फ्रॉम द सेम सोर्स ओके नाउ द नेक्स्ट थिंग इज फ्रेगमेंट ऑफसेट. अब फ्रेगमेंट ऑफसेट हमारा कहाँ काम आता है कि मैंने आपको बताया कि जो ये फ्रेगमेंट्स हैं ये डिफरेंट डिफरेंट टाइम पे या फिर डिफरेंट डिफरेंट पाथ फॉलो करके इस नेटवर्क पर पहुंच जाएंगे. राइट कोई पहले पहुंचेगा कोई बाद में पहुंचेगा. राइट सो टू आइडेंटिफाई कि कौन सा फ्रेगमेंट कौन से मतलब लाइक वी नो दैट दिस इज द फ्रेगमेंट नंबर 1, दिस इज फ्रेगमेंट नंबर 2 एंड दिस इज द फ्रेगमेंट नंबर 3. हाउ रिसीवर गेट टू नो, क्योंकि ये अलग अलग टाइम पे रिसीव हुए हैं, हाउ रिसीवर गेट टू नो कि कौन सा फ्रेगमेंट नंबर 1 है, कौन सा फ्रेगमेंट नंबर 2 है, कौन सा फ्रेगमेंट नंबर 3 है. सो फॉर दिस वी यूज फ्रेगमेंट ऑफसेट. सो फ्रेगमेंट ऑफसेट क्या करता है कि आउट ऑफ ऑर्डर जो सिक्वेंस है फ्रेगमेंट्स की, उन्हें क्या करते हैं इन ऑर्डर सिक्वेंस को प्रोवाइड करवाता है. तो फ्रेगमेंट ऑफसेट की क्या फंक्शनैलिटी है? कन्वर्ट करता है आउट ऑफ ऑर्डर सिक्वेंस को इन ऑर्डर सिक्वेंस के अंदर. ओके एक सिक्वेंस में बना के वो रखता है. ये दिस इज द फंक्शनैलिटी ऑफ फ्रेगमेंट ऑफसेट. राइट एंड देन द लास्ट वन इज फ्लेक्स. अब फ्लेक्स की क्या फंक्शनैलिटी है? लेट्स सपोज सो इफ यू टॉक अबाउट द फ्लेक्स, लेट्स टॉक अबाउट फ्लेक्स. सो फ्लेक्स आर बेसिकली ऑफ थ्री टाइप्स. सो द फर्स्ट टाइप इज जीरो फ्लैग. सो दे आर नॉट बेसिकली इन द यूज. द सेकेंड टाइप ऑफ फ्लैग्स आर DF फ्लैग्स. सो द मीनिंग ऑफ द DF फ्लैग इज डोंट फ्रेगमेंट. सो कि हम इससे ज़्यादा हम फ्रेगमेंट नहीं कर सकते उस पर्टिकुलर पैकेट की. एंड द नेक्स्ट फ्लैग इज मोर फ्रेगमेंट कि इससे ज़्यादा आप मोर फ्रेगमेंट मीन्स इससे ज़्यादा भी और फ्रेगमेंट्स हम कर सकते हैं. सो दीज थ्री काइंड्स ऑफ फ्लैग्स आर देयर. सो फ्रेगमेंटेशन के लिए फ्लेक्स इज ऑल्सो देयर. सो द लास्ट वन इज टाइप्स ऑफ सर्विस. टाइप्स ऑफ सर्विस बेसिकली इट्स नॉट यूज इन द फ्रेगमेंटेशन. बेसिकली इट्स स्पेसिफाई द डेटाग्राम प्रायोरिटीज एंड ऑल. सो विच इज नॉट रिलेटेड टू फ्रेगमेंटेशन. द वन इज टाइप ऑफ सर्विस. ओके